So I'm very happy to be giving this talk on this very special occasion, and even more happy that this is something that one our student Paramita Pramanik and I have been talking about. This is still sort of going through various changes. We keep getting together and find that something or the other can be made better. So this is definitely not in its final form. This is about an old theorem of Butter and Saw that many people consider to be rather mysterious. And it was sort of not really looked at very much for a while until Hercules school provided a proof that most ordinary mortals were able to read. The original proof by Butter Saw is completely dense and impossible to make sense of. So here is what's going on. There is a hierarchy that we call hypernormal. It's a very natural definition because one studies normal operators by spectral theory and you pretend to know everything about normal operators, which is when PT star is equal to P star P. Then you sort of start asking yourself, well, what else can you do if you are done with normal operators? What else would you want to do? And in the early days, the idea was to look at operators that share properties close to that of normal operators. One of these is to demand, rather than being equal to zero, what if it is positive? Although I will not talk about it, obviously you can talk about P star P minus E P star being negative, but we will just see what will work. That's called hypernormal. But as you can guess, even that is not really going to keep you close to normal operators. You need to say something about the size of this commutator, and typically that size is measured by working out some kind of a trace or a certain norm V class and so on and so forth. But for that, you must, to begin with, have a trace or trace class, that is the trace norm must be finite. To study these operators which have some kind of a trace, the mysterious theorem that Burgersaw proved in the very, very early days was that with a very slight assumption on the operator T, namely that it is a M cyclic operator, there will be some definition in a while. I just want to chat and tell you what this is about. So M cyclic, of course, means somehow the operator acting on vectors, finite set of vectors, generate enough of them inside the Hilbert space so that the complete circumposure becomes the whole of the Hilbert space. That's what M cyclic is. In the language of modules, it will be something like a finitely generated module. I mean, you know, the Hilbert space can be followed by a module and so on. The Burgersaw theorem, which is surprising because there is really no assumption on the operator other than saying that it is M cyclic, hypernormal. Hypernormal is just positivity. M cyclic is not really a big deal. I mean, it just says that the operator T acting on a finite set of vectors creates a large enough set. So from there, to get to the fact that the operator T star T is trace class is rather mysterious. What is even more mysterious is that Berger and Saw actually got an estimate for that trace of the commutator. The trace is estimated in terms of that cyclicity, M cyclic, and the area of the spectrum. Out of nowhere, area of the spectrum appears. So there is something geometric in the area, and that is connected with the trace. And this was way back, I think, in the early 70s. And several attempts to generalize this to the context where instead of looking at a single operator, you are looking at a commuting tuple of operators, has been not very successful. And here I mention only two names, There aren't really too many other results in this area. Amir Athavale was one of the first persons to look at the possibility of doing something with a commuting couple and hypernormality. Afterwards, Douglas and Yan, this is Ron Douglas and Karen Yan, they sort of looked at the same question and said that under very, very restrictive hypothesis, you could arrive at similar conclusions. But one of the things is that when you say similar conclusions, I don't even know what should be the appropriate definition when you are talking about a commuting couple, what should be the appropriate definition of a hypernormal couple. And that's going to be sort of the focus of what I want to say. I mean, of course, you want to prove theorems, but there is a question about what qualifies to be called a hypernormal operator. So the Douglas-Yan paper is sort of uses techniques from commutative algebra and basically reduces the problem of n variable to one variable and then apply Berger's theorem. So it's a technically powerful result, but you know, it doesn't really give you any insight in the sense that what is essentially new in the multivariable situation doesn't come out from this paper. So, okay. First of all, the question of cyclicity. What does one mean by cyclicity? And then we look at hypernormal. Cyclicity, of course, means, as I said, you look at a set of vectors, a finite set of them, m vectors with the property that if you look at a polynomial, remember that T1 through Tn are a commuting couple, so I can take a polynomial in n variable, plug these operators T in a rather you know, canonical way and apply vectors from that set that I have identified. And if I look at the linear span closure of this, that should be the entire Hilbert space. That's the sense in which I said this is not really a big deal. Most of the examples that one has, at least the day-to-day kind of business that one conducts, will involve operators which satisfy this property. So this is not really a big deal. Then the question becomes, what is actually a hypernormal operator? So Athavale proposed the following notion for a what one may call strongly hypernormal, in the sense that you look at Tj star Ti, you make the block operator, and then that block operator acting on the direct sum of the copies of n copies of the Hilbert space must be a positive operator. Even I have written this down very helpfully. The other definition is in some sense sort of a projective thing, where you say that rather than looking at this block operator, which is, as I said, the strong notion, you look at just the sums of the T1, T2, Tn, a linear polynomial. But for all linear polynomials, you demand that this operator must be positive. So the difference is here. And since, these two notions come up in various areas, they compete with each other, both in spectral theory. In fact, even in complex geometry, the notion of positivity for curvatures occur in these two different ways. I mean, let's not get. I wanted to talk about a little bit about that in a futuristic way, but Professor Sinha told me nothing doing. I have to only talk about. So all right, I'll refrain from. So now the question. We have a strongly or perhaps weakly hypernormal operator, which is cyclic. Sometimes I'll forget to write M cyclic. Of course, many of you who have heard me speak know that you know, there are typos and there are other you know, little things that I make. But this is, I should have said M cyclic. Strongly hypernormal M cyclic, then does it follow that this is necessarily trace class? That is the first question. I mean, after all, for one variable, just the cyclicity gave the fact that it is in trace class. The first thing to observe is that, I mean, you can do this as a homework thing, which is look at the head space of the bidisc and look at the pair of operators multiplication by Z1 and multiplication by Z2. These can be realized as M tensor I. You can think of H2 D2 as H2 D tensor H2 D and think of multiplication by Z1 as M tensor I on the first copy of H2 D and I on the other, and similarly MZ2 will be I tensor MZ. I on the first copy, MZ on the second. And looked at that way, it becomes abundantly clear. It doesn't even take a minute's thought, which is the usual thing to say. It becomes clear that this is not going to be trespass. Although it has the cyclicity property, it has the hypernormality and everything else, this is not going to be trespass. So that is why I kind of emphasize on the possibilities of making up the right definition, coming up with a if you like, even a conjecture, that will sort of carry the Burgersau theorem in a natural way. So what might be the possible generalization of the Burgersau theorem for the case of commuting tuples? And the two results that I mentioned, let me just say a little bit more. In the case of Athawale, he essentially said that the multiplicity assumption he strengthened quite a bit. He said that not only the commuting tuple is M cyclic, but each individual one. So if you think about it, that's quite each individual one has some kind of a cyclic property. That's too much to ask for. And Douglas and Yan, they made very, very strong assumptions on the spectrum. The joint spectrum in the sense of Taylor, basically requiring that the spectrum must be very thick, irrespective of the size of the tuple of the operator that you are looking at. The spectrum they demanded must be thin, and under those circumstances, each of them proved some kind of a trace class business. Here, temporarily, let me say, when I say trace class, what I mean is TJ star, commutator TI, each one of them is trace class, each individual. Now, what is it that we sort of are going to sort of do that's different, or that at least all of us are very excited about, is this, this idea that instead of looking at that matrix and demanding that to be positive, saying that means hypernormal, and then add to that cyclicity and hope you will get trace classness, somehow doesn't seem to work in a very natural way. Instead, we look at a determinant operator rather than looking at these n square objects, which are Tj star commutator Ti. Those are n square operators, and you demand that they must be all in trace class. Instead of that, I'm going to propose that we look at a single operator made out of those, and we will be happy if that one operator was in trace class. So I'll elaborate on this a little bit. So asking for just that one operator, you may argue, is not asking for much. But then to arrive at this conclusion, we don't assume much either. Now remember, when you say hypernormal, you are looking at a n by n block operator acting on direct n copies of the Hilbert space H, and you are demanding that that's positive. Instead, here, our assumption will be that the single determinant operator is positive, and from that, we'll extract the conclusion of being in trace class, which is, if you ask me, more in the spirit of how the Burgersau theorem. So as in the Burgersau theorem, of course, we will assume finite multiplicity, but instead of either strong or weak hypernormality, we only assume that the determinant is positive. Okay? And in many ways, it is a mild condition, and this gives us finiteness of the trace. What is more, we can even get the explicit bound in terms of the volume of the spectrum, which is something that has never been looked at in these last 50 years, if you like. So now let me kind of try to make this a little more concrete. So the determinant operator. And this is something I am very, very excited about. But of course, we all know what is a determinant. And there is lot said in terms of sure complement, this, that, and the other. If you look at block operator, Aij, where each Aij is a operator itself, how to write a scalar determinant out of this. Now we are going to put that aside. We take a block operator, but instead of looking at a scalar determinant, our determinant is going to be an operator itself, okay? And the way you do it is to, I mean, of course, if you think about it, the first difficulty you will face is that where you want to write down the grammar rule for determinants, and then say that, well, instead of scalars, you have operators so far. The problem with that sort of a definition would be, because these blocks may not be commutative, therefore that definition would not be really well defined. To make it well defined, of course, you do the most natural thing, namely, well, take all possible products. And that's what, no matter what this definition might look like, every time I stare at that definition, you know, it sort of jumps at me. But all you are doing is you are looking at, in the Cramer's rule, every term that is there, you allow for permutation of all those products, okay? Now don't ask me how many terms are there, I'll get confused. But it's just, okay, now, I mean, this I haven't written down, but this I want to just pause and say for 1 minute. If you look at the definition of the hypernormality, you said hypernormal means some block operator is positive. My hope here would be that someday one will prove that this is the top determinant, you have n by n block operator. You look at the top determinant and then you look at all the sub-determinant objects and you say that all those determinants are positive, then as in the scalar matrix case, I hope you should be able to get that the big matrix or big block operator is positive. I don't know about that, that's not relevant for this purpose, but I would like to offer that as a possibility for defining hypernormality. So now, the other issue here is that, quite unknown to me, while Kalyan knew about this, I had perhaps heard of it when I was a kid, but I forgot. So if you think about this definition of the determinant, again it shares the property with the ordinary determinant that if you think of LH, n copies, now this is the operator algebra, n copies of that, Cartesian product of n times and so on. The way this determinant is defined, it's actually a alternating multilinear map. So the question is, well, for this purpose, perhaps any alternating multilinear map would have served just as well. Therefore, you might wonder, well, what else is there? And before long, you quickly come across, particularly if Kalyan happens to be around, namely that there is this other one, which is called the generalized commutator that was introduced by Elton and Howe.
There's no averaging or something?
Which? Yeah, yeah. I mean, averaging over a second time. So you take any particular order, write down the determinant as if you have a scalar matrix, and then run over every possible other. Yeah. So there is a similar whatever, but I'll not go into various other nitty-gritties, but the point is, if you look at the generalized commutator as defined by Helton and Howe, you have to look at 2n of them in their language. So you look at a1, t1 star, a2 is t1, a3 will be t2 star and so on, you go up to 2n. And then there is a definition of generalized commutator, namely for this it will be this guy. Okay, but now notice that it is only one permutation group, but on 2n copies, I mean 2n elements. However, my good friend Cherian Burgess, who is usually pretty good at sort of looking at such things, we were sort of wondering, sitting there, what is, now we have two multilinear alternating maps and so on and so forth. So you know, are we really looking at two different things? And thankfully, it turns out there is only one. So Cherian helped us to settle this, but maybe there is some hint, although we could not extract a proof out of the Helton Howe paper, but we now in our own pedestrian way, we can see that these two things are equal. The question that remains in my mind is that how many other such animals are roaming the world? Okay, so there might be just generalized commutator and the determinant, but there might be a whole lot more. I don't know. And each one being positive might say something interesting about the commuting tuple that you are looking at. And just for the record, therefore, this is what it will look like if you do it for just the Hardy space. That is what I was talking about before. Looking at the multiplication by the two coordinate functions as m tensor I tensor m, you know, straightforward calculation shows you this. And from that, a whole lot of other things follow. The determinant operator, the point that I am making here, I'll end this thing by giving an example at the very end of a very different nature. So we began by saying that the Hardy space does not support this idea of generalizing the Burger-Shaw theorem, whereas if you look at the determinant, that's the whole point, that if you look at the determinant, then the determinant becomes a finite rank operator, okay? So the determinant is positive and
trace class.
And of course, the trace here, trace of determinant, sorry. My apologies, no matter how hard I try, of course, I have never prepared anything that is free of typos. That's the least of my problems. There are other problems also. But typos, yeah.
Can you repeat the definition of the determinant?
Sure. Yeah. So this is.
No. They're generalizing.
Oh, yeah, this one. Yeah, these A's are operators. This is a 2n tuple of operators, and it doesn't matter whether you multiply in one order or the other because you are running over the entire permutation.
But the first one is a number.
No. The first one is also an operator. So both are operators, and I'm saying that the answer in both cases restricted to what we are interested in, namely where we are looking at commutators of operators, they are the same. Okay. One of the ways you might say the reason for making that definition is to make Hardy space sort of be part of our story rather than not. I mean, leaving out Hardy space is always a try. And you must find a way of doing something that keeps the Hardy space in your backyard. Now let's get back to, some of the things that I am now going to talk about actually can be done with a commuting tuple of n operators. The proofs that we have at this moment are messy, to say the least. But there are ideas that I might mention at the very end if I have time, which sort of makes us feel that even the proofs can be made to look nice, so that the next time I give the same talk, I'll be able to give the talk with proofs that actually is for an n tuple. It's actually rather simple, but at the moment, I would like to stick to a pair of operators, but much of what I say actually goes through for a commuting n tuple of operators. So here are some notations. Let us just get that out of the way. This is a minimal set of generators now. Earlier I had said m cyclic, which is the same thing actually. So you look at m cyclic, this you take a minimal set of vectors which generate your Hilbert space, and then the main point is that this is the idea of Beculescu for the alternative proof, if you like, of the Gadadhar theorem, what he did was to kind of do make an approximation scheme by looking at these cyclic spaces, well, not quite cyclic spaces, I don't know what name you want to give it, give these, but for every natural number, you set this thing up so that your powers are limited. You are sort of looking at some kind of homogeneous polynomials up to degree something up there. And so that's one definition, and one wants to study or obtain this estimate on the trace or something by looking at what happens on these finite dimensional objects. And then this is new, this was not necessary in the proof of one variable. Here we are saying not only that you have this definition, but it will become clear, I'll show you snippets of the proof where it will become clear how or why we need these inequalities. The point is that if you try to write for an n tuple, I have to write a whole bunch of these inequalities, one for each, I mean, one to n, so to say, and that becomes a little. But even here, through the action of a permutation group, this, that, and the other, we are hopeful that if you make only the assumption one or this, the other assumption will actually fall. Okay? So you don't have to write them separately, is what I think we can do. But right now, that's something we are investigating. So this is in the nature of an assumption on the operator or the pair of operators. And wait a minute, a BSM. So the main thing, sorry. So the thing, of course, this is just the definition of the space, but I want to define what is called a class. I mean, what is the class of operators? In the one variable case, there was nothing to define because you said M cyclic hypernormal. You don't need a definition for that. But since for more than one variable, we have to make these assumptions, we introduce this class of operators which are what? Commuting are said to be in this class. This is M cyclic, and we have these properties. I should have included the determinant is positive. Okay? Here it is non-negative definite. So here it is being said separately, but it should have been included there itself, so I don't have to say it separately. So we take a pair of operators in this class. And the class means cyclicity, which is natural, the positivity of the determinant, which we are sort of saying is the new thing, but to make the proof work, what we need are these two estimates, okay? So there are some parts that come exactly as it should from the one variable case, and whereas there are some parts that are, okay, so now let's look at the proof a little bit. To do the proof, first of all, there is this lemma that one needs. This lemma already tells you that the determinant is trespass. Okay? And to be able to do this this thing, there is one trick. But apart from the trick, when you try to make a proof like this work, as I said, following the alternative proof that was given by Vekulescu, you will see the estimates that we have made come out in a natural way. So if you write down the determinant, you will get first these four expressions, and then you observe that if you look at term by term, you observe that you will be left with only two terms because some of these things will become zero. Okay? And once that happens, you are supposed to kind of work on these two terms that are left over, which, you know, by these two terms I mean you expand this, and once you expand this, you will be left with these, this, and you insert a pn perf plus pn somewhere in the middle, which is actually the identity that will lead you to something like this, okay? And it therefore boils down to working on this particular thing, but that is where your hypothesis will come and will tell you that the trace PND T, T is going to be bounded above by T1 norm square, T2 norm square, okay? But now, since the projections that were defined earlier on, namely, so the PNs were these projections. I don't know where I said it or did not say it, perhaps. So they increase, and therefore the estimates that increase to identity. So since I have these estimates involving the projections that actually increase to the identity, I'll be able to complete the inequality. Okay. So there are missing steps. They are actually in the form of a tech file somewhere or the other. I have taken, as I said, only some pieces to show you what is going on. This is going to identity. Therefore, we have this. That's one half of the thing. But the real interesting half, up to here, actually there was this was sort of said before, actually by Kalyan himself recently in another meeting. But what we now have found that the other estimate involving the volume of the spectrum also follows more or less a similar idea from the Bhakulaskupu. For that though, I must emphasize, we were a little confused for a while, but I must emphasize, here, these estimates, there are various choices for what you can do here. You can take, for example, a Hilbert-Smith norm, you can take a L1 norm, and you can try to make hypothesis. The question to ask would be, are these the most optimal sort of hypothesis that you need to make? At the moment, it looks like various other possibilities that you might try doesn't really lead to anything else that would be more interesting. And in particular, in some situations at least, the inequality involving the area or the volume of the spectrum that I have mentioned actually turns out to be sharp. And therefore, but there might be other situations where it is not sharp, that also can be said. So, this is much easier to, what did I write? T1, T2, of course, makes no sense. Yeah, right, sigma T1 intersection. I mean, I want to sort of really kind of draw a little picture and sort of say that if your spectrum is here, you sort of put it inside some kind of a ball, and in these outer places, you put some small balls, and on these small balls, these are actually balls, and you sort of say that you can approximate this spectrum by using these small balls, and this spectrum itself and this outer ball. The difference is going to be small by choosing those inside balls correctly. That is what will allow you to shrink the volume of this outer ball on which you can work to begin with, but then you can shrink it to the spectrum. But in the bar game, what you have to do is to look at your operator that was living here together with a bunch of other operators that are defined on these small balls, so that these small balls together with the spectrum is like the outside ball. I mean, all this can be said in a rather nice and technical way, but which I'll do in a minute. But the point is, yeah, there is already that one type of sigma T1 intersection sigma 2 is empty. And the whole purpose of that emptiness assumption. Emptiness is a good assumption. that tells you that you can actually pick your multiplicity to be the maximum of these two, because when you are talking about multiplicity, remember you are talking about holomorphic functions that sort of generate the inverse space. But if the spectrums are empty, the holomorphic functions on the union of the two spectrums, if their intersection is empty, is really holomorphic functions here, holomorphic functions there. That's what makes the holomorphic functions on the union of the spectrum. And since the intersection is empty, the spectrum of this T1 direct sum T2 is actually just the union of two spectrums, and therefore your holomorphic functions, they generate the ones that generate the first one and the ones that generate the second one can be used separately, and that is how you will get the max of. This is a very generic statement. This has nothing to do with anything. This is just about cyclicity of any pair of commuting operators. And of course, as you can see, trivially, it applies to n tuples of operators also, if the spectrums are intersection of the spectrums, or all the individual spectrums is empty. So the picture that I have drawn there is essentially to say that there is a Vitali covering lemma kind of thing. When one looked at the one variable case, it was perhaps not playing such a very crucial role. You had a disk and you had the spectrum and there was some gap, you tried to fill it in. But here, what happens is, I mean, as you can see, it sort of says that given an arbitrary set with finite measure, you have a Vitali covering, particularly if the measure has nice properties in particular Lebesgue measure, then you will have a Vitali covering. And what this is saying is that there is a finite such thing that you can choose, so that this measures of these things will be the measure of that minus delta for any delta positive value. And that's the picture that I have tried to draw there. The rest of it is going to be, I mean, these are things that one will have to sit down and actually compute. But the point is that the trace estimates that we have proved apply to each one of these operators, or the commuting pair of operators here, 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 and everywhere else. And then we are going to talk about taking, I mean, this is the estimate that we have taken, pi square over 2 summation rj square, where rj's are the radius of these little balls over here. And that, by the Vitali covering lemma, is going to be just this. Because the spectrum, by the general theory of Taylor joint spectrum, if you take any spectrum of a pair of commuting operators, what it is going to do is to sit inside the Cartesian product of the disk of spectral radius of the first one and the spectral radius of the second one. So this is a Cartesian product of two disks, the first one having the spectral radius R1, the other one having spectral radius R2, and so on. So you can put it inside. So this is the volume of that pi square T1 norm square, T2 norm square, is the outer body that I have drawn here. This outer body has that volume, and the Vitali sort of covering lemma tells me that I can make this less than the volume of the actual spectrum plus some small quantity. Okay, by looking at these volumes of the box. So this is the bigger volume. This is the other volume, and then this is the outside one, this is the small balls, and this is the spectrum. Okay? That's what now comes the actual construction of the operator. So as I said, what is going on? Let me just say it in words. There are things written down there. But what you are doing is you have some operator that you want to manage. But managing that operator directly in terms of the volume of the spectrum is not going to happen. So what instead Rafalescu came up with was the idea.
Two more minutes.
Okay. He came up with the idea that you can take a direct sum of your original operator with a bunch of redundant operators if you like, but in the end, you will be able to work with the direct sum of your operator that you are interested in and these redundant operators. The purpose for doing that is to say that you are able to manage the volume of the spectrum in terms of something that is already nice. This direct sum is the direct sum of the original operator here, bunch of these other operators. The proof is completed by simply saying this direct sum is arranged in such a way that once you make whatever estimate, m cyclicity and all that about your operator, the things that you are adding, these direct sums, are going to produce a new pair of operators satisfying exactly the same hypothesis. And because they satisfy exactly the same hypothesis, your earlier estimate applies. Okay? So that is what, in an elaborate way, is written down here. This is the new operator T direct sum that. These are the operators that live in this place. And so, you know, the spectrum of these operators, because they live here and here. Okay, I'll finish. So as I said, this whole construction of the operator, as best as I could, I have tried to explain, you know, in words. Let me finish by just saying this. There is a family of operators that you can define. Let's say a pair of weighted shifts, but these weighted shifts are of this particular form. They take a basis element and multiply with a certain weight, but the weight has this particular form, delta k l 1, what is this? L plus 1, k plus 2. I think that's what it is. So k minus l plus 1, k plus 2. It doesn't matter, these are the weights of the Hardy shift. And a simple computation then tells you, at least for this class of operators, how to compute the determinant operator as a pair of shift, as a single operator. So in this particular family, this is a very large family of operators. This is very well studied. These are what are called spherically balanced operators, and they are studied by Samir, Chavan, and Dmitry Akabovich. There are other people who study. They become part of what are called K homogeneous operators, their particular case. But the point of showing this example at the end is to say, now with this family, more or less anything you ask in terms of trace, in terms of volume, area, whatever, that those can be answered. And that proves, if you take what is called the Guri adjacency, no, if you take the Hardy tuple, it will prove that the inequality that we have got is actually solved. If I had more time, there was a tensor product version of this, there are other things what could have talked about, but I knew I won't be able to do more than this. So thank you very much.
Questions?
Which I made up for making life simpler for me. So, first of all, I mean, one cyclic simply means that you look at, this means there exists X in the Hilbert space H, such that P, T1 through Tm, this is a fixed X, there is one X, such that this with P in the polynomial ring this closure is actually all of it. So this will be one cyclic, but instead of that, if you say this is such that X comes from some other set, let us say A, where A is a set of n vectors, or m vectors rather, then I will call it m cyclic.
Those are independent.
Huh?
Xi's are independent.
Xi's are linearly independent, yeah. If you don't, then it will, yeah, I mean.
Well, it
Right, I always cut it down. I mean, that's why at some point I said some minimal generating set or something. Okay, if you have, yeah.
So the crucial point is that the n is a finite.
Yes. That is the crucial point in many situations. I mean, certainly in commutative algebra and some kind of other things that one tries to do in complex geometry, whatever. But yeah, that finiteness is the crucial. Yes.
Okay.